This is the story of Noah's Ark.
In the generations before the great flood, life was good. In fact, it was too good. It was a life of never-ending peace and enjoyment. For example, children were conceived and born in just one day, and every newborn child was able to stand and walk right away, and was able to speak immediately. Also, no child would ever die as long as his parents were still alive. In fact, all parents would live to see not only their children, but also their grandchildren.
The generations before the Great Flood were very strong in their physical strength. The average person lived for hundreds of years, and their great strength did not get weaker in their old age, but just the opposite happened. They became stronger with age. This amazing human strength only disappeared after the flood was already over. For as the Torah says, there were giants on earth in those days. They were able to tear an entire tree, including the roots, right out of the ground. And lion and panthers, they were as harmless as little kittens.
Before the flood, people lived for a very long time. Most people lived hundreds of years. Only when they sinned did Hashem change the length of a person's life by saying,
"And his days shall be 120 years.
In addition to their great strength and very long lives, the generations before the flood knew no suffering of any kind. They planted seeds only once every 40 years, and the earth produced enough food from that one planting to last for the following 40 years. The temperature never became very hot nor very cold, because there were no changing seasons. The weather was always a very pleasant spring-like temperature. It was only after the flood that Hashem created four different seasons with changes in weather and temperature.
One would think that because Hashem had given the generations before the flood such amazing blessings, the people in those days would have been very thankful and would have obeyed Hashem's wishes. But sadly, the exact opposite happened. It was easy for a person to forget that living a good life was a blessing from Hashem. With so many precious blessings, one would think that man would never forget to show thanks to Hashem. But indeed, man did begin to forget. Not only did they not thank Hashem for all these gifts, but the generations began to look upon Hashem with great disrespect.
For what purpose do we still need Hashem? We don't even need his help to get water. Since we need no rain, why, there is plenty of water right here in our streams and wells.
Yeah, leave us alone, Hashem. Go away from us, for we do not want to know your ways. Who is Hashem that we should serve him? Why should we pray to him?
Now, that doesn't make any sense at all, does it? After all, it is Hashem who created the heavens and the earth, and all that exists in the world, including the streams and the wells. And so Hashem became angry and thought to himself,
"Is it with the very goodness that I have shown you that you turn against me? I shall therefore punish you with the very same rainwater, and I shall bring a great flood."
No one can say that Hashem is not patient. Why, He waited 10 generations from the time that he created the first man, Adam, and with each generation, the people got worse and worse. There was the sin of Avodah Zarah, worshipping idols. They prayed to trees and stars and rivers and mountains and animals. There was murder and cruelty to animals. Finally, there was robbery and disrespect for one's fellow man. There were no laws, and everyone did as they pleased. There were no judges, no courts, and no trust between man and his neighbor. They turned their backs to Hashem, who was the very source of their lives and all their blessings.
As any Jew knows, Hashem can forgive almost any sin. But when the world is filled with hatred for a fellow man, instead of peace and harmony, it is time for Hashem to step in. These people had to be taught an important lesson. And since water was the example they used to challenge Hashem's power, Hashem would punish them with a rain so great that it would flood the earth, destroying every living creature on earth, except for one man and his family.
Part 2. Noah, a righteous man amongst the wicked.
For in all the world, only one man was worthy to be saved from the fate that would befall mankind. This man's name was Noah. Noah was the great tzaddik of his time, a man who truly believed in Hashem and saw past the false belief of his generation. He appreciated the wonderful brachas that Hashem provided for mankind, and he taught his family to thank Hashem for the life of health and leisure they all led. Noah's own deeds were perfect. He did not allow himself to be affected by the wicked people of his day. He suffered the many insults of the wicked people during the 3 generations in whose time Noah lived. The generation of Enosh, the generation of the great flood, and the generation of the dispersal. And Noah remained honest and faithful in his service of Hashem. He faithfully observed the 6 mitzvos which Hashem had commanded Adam Harishon.
Noah's wife, Naama, was equally as righteous as Noah was. Her name, Naama, means that her deeds were pleasing. She gave birth to 3 sons, Yefes, Cham, and Shem, who all followed Hashem's ways as taught to them by their father Noah.
Part 3. Hashem reveals the future to Noah.
Hashem told Noah what the future would be. Hashem said,
"Behold, I shall bring a flood which will destroy not only all living beings, but also all the animals, all the plants and trees, and anything else that lives, until 1 foot deep into the ground."
Hashem then instructed Noah, saying,
"Make yourself an ark of gopher wood containing 3 floors. The lowest floor will be for garbage. The middle floor is where the animals shall live, and the top floor is where the people will be."
Hashem explained to Noah the exact way in which the ark was to be built. saying,
"The ark shall be made with entirely rooms. You will cover the ark from inside and outside with tar. Go to the river Pishon and bring from there precious stones which will make light for inside the ark. I want you to know that the flood will destroy all living creatures, but you shall enter and live in the ark. You and your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives.
Upon hearing the words of Hashem,
you shall be saved in an ark."
Noah should have begged Hashem to be merciful and spare the rest of the world. But Noah did not use that chance to speak up on behalf of his fellow human beings. Noah was different from Moshe Rabbeinu, who prayed until Hashem forgave all of Israel of their sins. Noah failed to pray for his generation. Hashem continued to instruct Noah, saying,
"Bring to the ark all the animals on earth. Take a male and a female of every type of animal that is not kosher, and seven males and seven females of all the other animals that the Torah in the future will declare kosher."
"How can I fulfill your command, Hashem? Am I a hunter who can recognize all the different types of animals and catch them all?"
Hashem answered, saying,
"You need not catch the animals. They will come to the ark by themselves."
Hashem then promised Noah, saying,
"I will establish my promise with you. No food that you bring into the ark will spoil. My promise also will protect you, so that the wicked men of the generation shall be unable to harm you, nor will they be able to stop you from entering the ark, in spite of their being stronger than you."
Part 4. Noah builds the ark and gathers the animals.
Noah spent 120 years building the ark. He was told by Hashem the secret of how to grow trees to make them the exact length needed for the wood that would be used in making the ark. Noah learned which tree had to be planted 120 years in advance in order for it to grow later to the correct size. He learned how long it took a tree to grow to the size of 300 amos, and how long it took a tree to become 30 or 50 amos high. Noah planted each tree at the right time, so that it would later become the right size for the ark. Noah personally was commanded to plant the trees for the wood of the ark, since the ark possessed a degree of holiness like the holiness of the Mishkan in the desert.
Hashem could surely have saved Noah from the flood in easier ways than by making Noah build an ark. For example, Hashem could simply have commanded the waters of the flood not to touch Noah's house. Why then did Hashem give Noah the difficult job of building an ark? There are many reasons why Hashem chose building an ark as the way for Noah to be saved from the flood.
One reason is that the great work needed for building the ark attracted everyone's attention worldwide. The building of the ark, therefore, acted as a warning to the wicked people in Noah's generation to change their bad ways. Noah was asked by many of the evil people,
"Why are you so busy building an ark?"
"This is the commandment of the Master of the Universe to me. Hashem plans to bring a great flood upon the world."
"If there will ever be a flood, let it be upon your own house."
Although the generation before the flood was given 120 years' time to think about Noah's words and change their evil ways, no one was ever impressed by Noah's constant warnings.
Everybody, everybody, please listen. Hashem spoke to me. Hashem wants everybody to stop doing the evil things that are being done. If this bad behavior is not stopped, Hashem will bring a flood like has never before been seen in all of history.
People did not fear any danger from Hashem because they felt secure in the knowledge of their great strength.
We are giants and we control the universe. Should Hashem bring water from above, it will not reach any higher than our necks since we are so tall. Should Hashem bring water from below, we will step on the wells in the ground with our heels to stop that water too. No power in the world can harm us. We know all about the angels appointed over fire and over water and over each creation in the universe. We can fight all of them by means of witchcraft.
Besides their very great strength, these bad men were also experts in the art of magic. They therefore felt themselves to be stronger and wiser than Hashem. And so, foolishly, they were not afraid of Hashem.
Part 5. The Last 7 Days. The entire 120 years given by Hashem to the wicked people in the generation before the flood as a chance to make them think about their evil ways, went by without any changes on their part. Finally, Hashem granted them yet another 7 days of opportunity to stop their bad behavior. 7 days before the beginning of the flood, Hashem changed the laws of nature, and all the bad people saw big changes in the world, which could not be ignored. The sun rose in the west and set in the east, which is the exact opposite of how the sun normally moves across the sky. The whole world in these 7 days was changed into a heavenly place. People found the world all of a sudden very much like it was in Gan Eden. There was extra delicious fruits everywhere. For 7 days, life became a non-stop party. Hashem hoped that by making things so delicious and beautiful, by showing everyone the great reward reserved for the good people in the world to come, that the bad people would repent.
But in spite of everything that Hashem did to make the bad people change their ways, they ignored them all. And so Hashem was very sad that the time had come to punish these bad people and purify the world with the greatest flood to ever happen in the history of the world. During the last 7 days before the flood, Noah was busy gathering together the pure animals. The pure animals did not come to the ark by themselves like the impure animals did. The pure animals were later to become sacrifices, and Noah's hard work to capture them would bring Noah much more reward for the mitzvah of bringing these sacrifices.
The ark did not permit all the animals to enter. The ark rejected those animals that had behaved badly. Only those animals that were free of sin could get inside the ark.